So many themes that you could pick upon for Palm Sunday, so it's good for the next 20, 50 years. But one that I chose today was, as it is in the video clip, the theme of humility. Mark Twain wrote a story, I believe it's The Prince and the Pauper. So forgive me for, I like Mark Twain's writings, and so I go to them every now and again. The story of The Prince and the Pauper is two young boys who looked very much alike, decided to switch places. One was a prince, one was a poor boy. And they were able to get away with it, not without some comedy, some humor for both of them. But in the end, Mark Twain makes the point that for the young boy that was the prince, he had a great time. But the prince that had become a pauper had not had such a good time. And he vowed when he would become the prince again, that he would treat people differently. It's an interesting teaching, okay? And so the book is a secular book, of course, but it has interesting teachings on this Palm Sunday for us. I'd like to take that just a little bit further. I always do with any illustration that God gives to me, and play with it a little bit. And so in that spirit, I'd like you to think that we switch places. Only the person that we switch places with is a criminal. This criminal has been condemned to die. There was a movie that was about 30 years ago that had that theme, right? The Fugitive, set in Chicago and so on. That's a long time ago, but if you can remember that, Harrison Ford and so on. And just picture yourself in the place of Harrison Ford, and you're spared. But you're on the run from city to city. You take on odd jobs. You look for the one-armed man, you know, because he is your ticket to freedom. But until you find him, the court has condemned you to death. So there'd be some excitement, you know, in that being on the run and meeting different people and so on, and always disguising yourself and so on. But finally, one day, they catch up to you and they arrest you. And now you have to pay the price. What do you do? Well, if it were me, I think I would try everything I could think of, from fingerprints to DNA to other proofs, to say that somebody stole my identity. I would try and get out of it, okay, that, to my last breath. That's the one option. The other option is, would you be quiet and pray that giving up your life might give freedom to that other person, and they would change their ways? Interesting thought, isn't it? Jesus did that very thing. He was the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and enjoyed all the majesty of being one with God in heaven. We like to think sometimes humility is just being extra polite to people, but it's more than that. It's not just being extra nice and letting others go ahead. It's your whole lifestyle. You give up everything, and you become a pauper. Now, we think being human isn't so bad, but when you're the King of Kings and you become a human, it's a step down, a big step down. And to make sure that we got that, God sent his son to be born not of the richest family, but of Mary and Joseph. And the scripture, little hints make us show that they weren't rich. They lived in a little town, out of the way. Nobody famous came from that town. Yet that's where Jesus came down from heaven and was born to be our Savior. You know, the little video clip picks up on some things in our culture, and I'd like to go just a little bit further with a couple of things for us to think about. And I prayed and I pray again that God would help me pull this off in the right spirit. Okay, so you pray for me too. But in our culture today, you know, we're so aware of privilege, and Jesus is anti-privilege. But before we go back to him, I'd like you to think about it in our society. The key word today is white privilege, isn't it? I'd like to hold back just a little bit. I'm sure that it is. Okay? I don't want to get into trouble debating that. But I'll tell you, there are other privileges that are higher up on the rung of that ladder. One is the privilege of your last name or the connections. If you have the name of Kennedy, you can go places. In the south suburbs, I lived there for a little bit of time. If you have the name of Jackson, people will ask you, tell us who your father was. If it's Jesse, you can go a lot of places. And so it doesn't matter, you know, where you come from, as long as you have the right last name and you have connections, you can go to the ends of the earth. If you don't have that, well then, the other ticket to privilege is money. If you got a lot of it, you can buy your way anywhere, and people will listen to you. They might not right at first, I know how privilege works, but they begin to notice, and oh, that's Rockefeller's. Oh, that's CEO of Bill Gates, Microsoft. And if you got money, people want your opinion and they listen to you. And if you can't make it that way, then your privilege can be a special talent, say in sports or entertainment. And once you have it made in those areas, you can go anywhere, to New York, LA, people accept you right away. They bow down to you, they welcome you. They accept you like nobody else. And then I would put after that, race. People do look at the color of your skin. I know that. God help us. And then at the very end would be your work ethic. Nobody really cares how hard you work. If you have a good last name, you can work and not do anything and continue to make millions as an advisor. You don't believe me? You haven't listened to the news. It gets covered up, but that's the way it goes. If you've got a good last name, you don't really have to work, and you have lots of money. You have a good salary. And so as I think about that, you know, if we could have a choice, like Jesus, to come into the world and to be born in a certain way, well, okay, I got to be born. That's the way. But I'd like to have some privilege. Couldn't I be number one, you know, in a palace? Guess what? Moses didn't enjoy the palace life. But that would be our thought, wouldn't it? The palace life would be pretty good. And if not, well then just in some occupation where I would be treated equal to everybody else. Hasn't that been our hope for racial equality and so on? Don't treat one better than the other, just treat everybody the same. Well, wouldn't that be something? No, Jesus didn't choose the privilege of being way up there or equal. He chose to be the underdog. That's the whole lifestyle that I want you to think of in terms of humility. The angels could have cried the night he was born. Instead, they rejoiced. They sang, glory, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill to men. They knew that this was God's plan. And it was a plan of humility, not being the first, but being the last. And as he's born as a baby and begins his life among us, I think, you know, there are things where I just wouldn't, had I been his advisor, I would have had a different opinion. One of them was, Lord, your ministry is just always criticized. Have you noticed that other Pharisees are always in your face? Can't we do something about that? Change the message a little bit or tell them off. You know, get tough with them. I came up with, you know, just being criticized all the time. You get sick of it. There's a story of, I don't know if you've heard of it, of a grandpa and his grandson and their donkey. And they that's all they have. So in the old country, so on, they decide to go from one village to a couple of villages down the road. And so they both ride on the donkey and they get into this first village and everybody's so upset. I mean, that's animal abuse. Two of you big people on a little donkey. So they didn't want to offend anybody. So the grandpa got off and let the grandson ride the donkey. And they got to the next town. Everybody was upset. You talk about elder abuse. This little kid making his grandpa walk. So they didn't want to offend those people. So the next place, the grandpa got on the donkey and the grandson walked. They got to the next town. Everybody's upset. Talk about child abuse. You should know better than that to make a little child suffer and walk. So what are they? Well, they went in the next town, and the grandpa was carrying the front of the donkey, and the grandson was carrying the back of the donkey. And everybody like us laughed their heads off, but at least nobody criticized them. Doesn't that make you sick? That's the world in which we live. Come on, give us a break at some time. Jesus put up with that. Humility. He kept true to the word, which is so tough for us. Right? We want to give in. No, he didn't give in. But he accepted the abuse all the time. So much so that as we look forward to this week, they nailed him to the cross. And with that challenge, if there ever would have been a time that's it. You know, if you're the Christ, come down from the cross. I would have shown them a thing or two. Yeah. Right? Yeah. If you want me to come down, you better start running now. And yet that wasn't the Lord's way. His way is the way of humility. And that's what I want you to think of and consider in our own lives. Jesus not only taught that the first shall be last and the last shall be first, but he lived it. And that's our story too. You know, again, as I go back to thinking of the beginning, switching places with somebody, I think we'd always choose to switch places or to have at least a connection with somebody that's a little bit higher up in some way than us. I want you to consider it's just the other way. Just make sure you have a connection to somebody that you think, and God will teach you that they're not, but somebody that you think is not quite up there with you. On the other hand, those that are rich, you know, their lives just teach us how even at the best of times, life is not so good. And at the worst of times when you have faith, then God makes his forgiveness and his healing extra sweet. This week, a couple of times, so it's something of the Lord where in my own life, and I hope I can share with you in the right spirit, the background to a hymn that you may know and I love. It's called "It Is Well with My Soul." And you know that? Do you know the background to that hymn? It was written by a man. The words were at least by a man whose name was Horatio Spafford. If that doesn't mean anything to you, he has a connection to us. He was a lawyer in the 1870s in Chicago. He was well off. He had five children. His wife's name was Anna. They were blessed until 1871, had all sorts of riches. 1871, he lost his son to scarlet fever or pneumonia. Then the fire came. They lost everything. They had to rebuild. God was good. They were able to recover. So much so that in 1873, it had been such a lousy 2 years that Horatio said to Anna, "Why don't you take the girls and go to Europe and have a vacation, and I will join you there later." And so they went on a boat, and the boat crashed with another boat, and all of them fell into the sea. Anna tried her best to keep her daughters afloat, but only she was able to hold on to the wreckage and be saved by a passing boat. All four girls gone. And so she sent a telegram from Wales to her husband, "Saved but alone. What do I do?" "What do you do?" And so her husband booked passage on the next ship and came over to Wales. That was his plan. On the way, the captain of the boat knew his story and stopped for a moment. He says, "You know, this is the place where the boat went down. This is the resting place of your daughters." And again, as I say to you, Doesn't matter how rich or poor you are. In our darkest times, that's when God can give to us the sweetest message of forgiveness and healing. It was at that time that he wrote the words, "It is well with my soul. When peace like a river attendeth thy way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul." And when you sing, he didn't write the music, but when you sing the music to that, it is well with my soul. It brings a comfort, doesn't it? It's a sweet comfort. It never gets old. And yet it was born out of one of the worst tragedies you could ever think a family having to go through. And so riches, you know, if they weren't so rich, they wouldn't have gone to Europe, right? Would have been stuck in Chicago. Well, maybe that ain't so bad. There's things to do here. But riches, you know, just has its own thing. And so humility isn't such a bad thing, especially when we choose to be one with other people rather than put down. Jesus chose that. Nobody foisted it on him. He chose that way. And so in our lives too, we choose that. Knowing that God, just as he exalted Jesus, 1 week from today, after Good Friday, we celebrate that Jesus rose again. He was victorious. And so for us too, sometimes, you know, somebody says, no good deed goes unpunished. So sometimes we get criticized and we love to fire, well, I did my best, you know. But when we take our Lord's humility, we have the same confidence that in God's time, he exalts us. Even if it's in heaven, that would be the sweetest time, won't it? I need to share with you. In my life, sometimes, you know, I reflect on some people that maybe weren't the kindest to me. And as I reflect on that, God sometimes, you know, paid them back. The trouble was, is I was never there to have a smile. Isn't that frustrating? You'd like to have, no, God doesn't promise for us to have the last laugh. It's always his. He does promise, though, to exalt us. The way to that, though, is not by being first, but by being last. Dear ones in the Lord, it comes only from following Jesus. So it's his words and promises. It's not my promises. It's his, right, to always be with us and to lift us up just as he modeled that in his life. So may you be filled with the Spirit of the Lord Jesus, and then his humility will shine through to others, not only lifting them up, but on the last day to lift you up also. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.